Good evening. Happy Independence Day to all. I, Prajakta Adhikari, on behalf of the Institute of Environmental Architecture and Research, warmly welcomes all our participants and our panelists for today. The Institute of Environmental Architecture and Research, which is a Mumbai-based educational research and training institute with a vision to create a sustainable environment through scientific research, education and training, socio-cultural understanding, community engagement and awareness. We are a multidisciplinary group of scientists, professionals, and academicians who have joined forces to form this organization, having worked collaboratively for more than 15 years on education, environment consultancy, and awareness. Our mission is Environment First. This is the seventh webinar in the series, which we started during the lockdown period. So far, we have reached out to more than 1,000 participants altogether. Our main objective in this webinar series is to provide educational and research inputs and a scientific and analytical approach to environmental issues. I would now welcome our moderator, Dr. Roshni Yehuda, President of IEAR, to introduce our today's panel.
Good evening, everyone, and happy Independence Day to all of you. Before I introduce to you our eminent panelists, I'll just brief a little bit about this topic of today, which is waste management in cities. This is a topic that probably is known to everybody. It's one of the biggest challenges that we are facing today in our cities, from school children to teachers to, you know, college students and everybody, housewives, office goers, they all face this problem on a day-to-day basis as we see garbage everywhere in the city. So in terms of technologies, we have seen that there are n number of technologies that have come in the market with respect to whether it is organic composting, recycling, we have biomethanation, pyrolysis, you name it, vermicomposting. I have seen in different parts of the world all kinds of solutions for waste management, and there are different types of technologies. We even have solutions which are related to, you know, social aspects, such as we have advanced locality management, where a group of people have come together and are taking care of the waste or are collaboratively taking decisions about waste. And we've had this for almost more than a decade now in places like Mumbai. And there are many other places where even we have policies, you know, there are some incentives given for waste management, like property tax rebate or, you know, even other things related to given by the urban local bodies. With all this, we still find that the problem of waste exists. It has not disappeared, and we are still grappling how to deal with this waste management currently in our cities, but also in the future in small towns and villages. This problem seems to be everywhere. When we see plastics in the fields, or when we see the water bodies full of solid waste, it's a sad story about a country like ours, wherein so many cities are having this kind of cities, and urban areas and rural areas are having these issues. So we have not been able to manage the waste sustainably, properly, and we have polluting dumping grounds coming all over the place. And this is the situation that we want to avoid. So in order to discuss this issue and to see whether what kind of solutions can be possible, we have here people today in our panel who have literally, you know, made their hands dirty working with garbage, and have tons of experience actually having developed, having implemented things on a in a real time. And each one of them, I would say, is a sort of inspiration to us all in terms of the work that they have done and the contribution that they have done to society. And it is my absolute pleasure to introduce to you all of them. I will just show you, I think, a few slides. If I can share the screen. Yeah, thanks. So our first panelist whom I would like to introduce is Jyoti Mapsekar. I have known her for so long, especially from the academy days where she was a librarian. She is 71, but then doesn't matter because she is so busy doing her work on a daily basis. She has been an active member of the women's movement of India since 1975, one of the founder members of Stri Mukti Sangatna, and at present the president of this organization. She's a qualified librarian, postgraduate in sociology. She's an Ashoka Fellow, and she voluntarily retired from the post of chief librarian from the Academy of Architecture in 2001 and devoted all her energies in organizing 5,000 Way Speaker members in self-help groups in a program called Parisar Vikas or Neighborhood Development, and trained about 1,000 members in composting, biomethanation, and other alternate skills. She has received numerous awards for her contribution to women's movement. Prominent among them are Hirkani Award from Mumbai Doordarshan, Savitri Bai Phule Award from Government of Maharashtra, and in March 2016, Nari Shakti Puraskar for Women's Empowerment through the President of India. She's also received the Green Hero Award from the US Embassy and Terry, and she was felicitated by the Clinton Foundation and Maharashtra Foundation in US in 2011. The Japanese Broadcasting Corporation has made a documentary on her for a program for their program Asia at Crossroads in 1999. So that's in a very nutshell about Jyoti. She has done so much work that it's impossible to describe all of it over here. Our next panelist is Kedar Soni. He's an alumnus of IIT Bombay and IIM Lucknow. He has been an entrepreneur in the research and analytics space for the last 20 years. About 3 years ago, he started this Green Communities Foundation to work on the problem of waste management. GCF works with urban and rural communities to implement segregation at source, composting, and recycling to prevent waste from getting littered, burnt, or dumped. In the last 4 months, GCF has enabled distribution of dry ration kits to over 18,000 families, wow, across relatively needy communities in Mumbai. So yes, Kedar also I've interacted with him extensively and seen that his passion in solving this problem of waste management. And our last panelist is Monisha Narke. She is founder and CEO of RUR Green Life Private Limited. She's an engineer in electronics from VJTI Mumbai and pursued her master's in industrial engineering and management from Stanford University, USA. She is a passionate environmentalist working with a vision to create eco-conscious citizens and develop solutions to maximize recycling of waste to a resource. She was awarded as the Entrepreneur of the Year 2017, has been passionately working towards bringing positive changes through various CSR, EPR, and eco-edutainment programs. She has designed an innovative aerobic composter, patent, filed and Green Pro certified, which are active across 110 decentralized waste management projects that manage to recycle about 500 tons of biodegradable waste into compost, annually increasing the green cover. She received the Biocomposting Excellence Award from Solid Waste Management Association of North America. She also drives Go Green with Tetra Pak in Mumbai in a strong partnership with Tetra Pak, Sahakari Bandar and Reliance Fresh Stores since 2010, which aims at recycling post-consumer Tetra Pak cartons into school desk for the less privileged schools. I think Monisha is also such an inspiration in the sense that she's created an opportunity in waste people can do business out of this. Waste is not waste in that sense. It is a resource, it is wealth. That is what Monisha has shown us. So all of these great panelists are with us, and I'm going to start the discussion today with Jyoti Mapsekar. Jyoti, you took voluntary retirement in 2001 from your post as a chief librarian at the Academy of Architecture in Mumbai to work full time in what you believed in, in waste management and women's welfare. So tell us in a brief, what inspired you? Give us a brief of your journey in waste management and your experiences.
Yeah, as you have earlier introduced me, I have been working as an activist in women's movement, even when I was working at Academy of Architecture. But Academy of Architecture also, because I was a librarian, I used to see the books on environment. And I also found that nothing is written in the syllabus of architecture about the waste management. When I started discussing with the different professors about the waste management, I realized that we had to do something, but we did not know how to do it. But we also wanted, as Srimukti Sanghatna, we wanted to work with the waste speakers, who were almost 80% of them are women. So when we started working with waste speakers, first we thought that we can have their self-help groups or education or health, their health, etc. But I also realized that right from 75 to 2000, I was working woman, though I was a trustee of Srimukti Sanghatna also. I was busy with our theater and performing our play, Mugis Aliyu and all. So that didn't take that much time, and academy was always flexible. But still, I realized that working with waste speaker is not that easy. I'll have to work full time. Then only I can give justice to that work. So I left my job, and waste speakers, actually conditions only inspired me, because I thought I had to do something for them. And there were the issues of poverty, but there were also issues of education, child marriage, health, so many issues. And also we realized, me and my other colleagues in Srimukti Sanghatna, that we have to understand what is to be done with the waste. We cannot just work from outside. We have to go inside and find out about details about the waste, how we can give value addition to waste speakers' work, how we can give them training. So all these things inspired me. I thought that I had to leave my job now, and that's why I started working with the waste speakers.
Yeah, can you give us some little bit more about the work that you have done? I know that you have the work you started with biogas and the providing services to societies in terms of complete waste management in the societies. Can you give us a brief about how you did that? What were the barriers that you faced, and what kind of service that you end up giving societies nowadays? And are there zero garbage societies that exist that you support, organization supports?
Yes, we thought that we must teach composting first. I mean, biogas came quite later. We started with composting, and there were some classes going on the for the middle class, as a hobby, terrace gardening and compost making and all that. So when I came across such class, I thought our waste speaker women will learn better. But remember that even waste speakers were not ready to do composting work, because dry waste brings instant money. You fetch dry waste and sell it in the evening, and you will immediately get money. If you want to have compost, first of all, there is no value for compost. And how they will get money? Only after 45 days. So they were not interested. Also, wet waste is quite dirty. Dry waste, though it is dirty, but they can pick up, whatever they can get from that wet waste. So from both sides, we had to argue and convince and motivate. Even the middle class also, they have ample place for parking, but they don't want to keep a space for composting pit. So that was also another struggle with middle class and municipal corporation. So many things were there, and we had to convince everyone. But fortunately, as early as 2003, we came across Dr. Kale, who was a scientist from BARC, and he has developed one model for biogas. And then he liked the idea that waste speaker, if we give them training, though they are totally illiterate, but his model is so simple that even waste speakers can manage that biogas plant, and that they still manage it. So this was a very good idea, and we under his guidance, we trained waste speaker women for biogas. So composting and biogas, and then they started. We started developing zero waste complexes, like it's decentralized waste management. So now you can imagine that BRC generates almost 8 tons of waste. So our women work on their biogas plants. They compost almost 5 tons of waste every day, and also manage dry waste. So all these three things combined. So imagine that such a big colony, which is zero waste. So only MLP, which is reject waste and all that, goes out. So there are several such colonies and complex housing complexes where we are working. So this has, you know, given a good opportunity, new opportunity to West speakers to learn and then get kind of a, I mean, work as a service provider. These women who had no fixed working hours, no, I mean, fluctuating wages. I mean, there were no wages, only fluctuating income, you can say, no holidays. And they, when they started working, then they started getting that and they started to save also. So this was a total change in their lives. Also, we saw that their children go to school, because otherwise there were all child marriages. When we started working in 2000, no girl was going beyond 8th standard. So that we completely stopped now. And girls are completing their 10th standard and going to colleges, becoming graduates. Their sons are also going and doing different jobs, taking different training. And also we are having health camps for them because they work in the toxic waste. And it's very dirty and unhygienic for them. I mean, see, but today's COVID times, how West speakers must be working. So from all angles, we started looking at their issues. And of course, we had their self-help groups.
That is fantastic. I think, Jyoti, you are probably one of the few people who have looked at the human dimension of waste. Because when we look at waste, we look at technologies, we look at how people can do it. But what about the people who handle it? And what about their own livelihoods and their families and so on? So your organization has supported them, provided them health benefits, you know, taught them about what they should be careful about and so on. So this is absolutely great stuff. And there are two things you mentioned. One is the social dimension that we talked about. Another is also the economic dimension about what is valuable in waste. So
yes.
I would like to hear a little bit more from you, because I remember having discussions with you and also Sulakshana Mahajan on you know, what kind of waste they pick up. Some waste is not at all useful and so on, some like caps and things like that. So in terms of the value of even the recyclables, well, what is the general trend, and how do you see this as a, is there a barrier, or what can we do about it?
Yeah, actually waste, if we say, though municipality doesn't say at all, but it should be divided into three types first, beginning. One is the dry waste, pet waste and hazardous waste. But in hazardous waste also there are so many parts. Like some hazardous waste can be recycled, like e-waste, you know, or construction waste. As an architect, you must be knowing that construction waste can be recycled, but of course nobody recycles it. Yeah. And also medical waste. I mean, I have seen that Nepal has a model. It's such a small country, but they have a model that without incineration, you can treat medical waste. So, and then there is a reject waste. Sanitary napkins are there, sanitary waste, sanitary napkins, now masks or diapers. All these things, you know, people just throw indiscriminately.
Yes.
And really, you imagine a waste picker who is opening that bag of sanitary napkin and then she's throwing it again. Imagine that all such bags of women who are using sanitary napkins, still only 50% or 60% women must be using sanitary napkins. And all that, those sanitary napkins go to dumping ground, so nobody wants to touch it. So they remain in the plastic bag. So that 18th floor dumping ground, which is at Devnar. So it's a huge problem. But nobody tells women that you put it, wrap it in the, at least into the paper and throw it, or mark it so that waste pickers or municipal worker won't pick it up, or separately they will send it to dumping ground as a reject waste. Another question you raised before this is that any informal sector, wherever women are working there, let it be any informal sector, moment it becomes formal, you know, women are thrown out and men grab all the jobs. So unless and until we could teach them that technology, they won't come forward and work in that.
Wow.
All these women must be starving, you know, once the system comes there.
Mm.
So we wanted to introduce them. So this, even Swachha, not Swachha, the Swachha Bharat Mission had come in 2016 or something. And still our women were working in this till from 2001. So we were quite ahead of time.
Yes, yes. It's a very strong statement that you have made, that whenever informal sector is turned,
yes,
formal sector women are thrown out. It's a sad state in this day and
yes,
we have to say this. But unfortunately, you have the experience and you say this and we have to believe this. I just want to ask you one last question before I move on to the next panelist. What was your experience with the local municipal corporation or any other local body? Did you get a lot of support from them? Were there any policy issues that you had to deal with? What was your experience?
Actually, when the development plan was made, there we had to give all our suggestions, you know, that there should be drivage centers, because where you will take that drivage? It should actually, in the rules also, the drivage should not go to dumping ground. It should go directly to the recycler. But for that, there should be some shade or something, you know, and we have given design. We have given design to municipal corporation. However, implementation, you see, there are all policies. Of course, there is no policy for waste pickers, even today. Though they are a very important stakeholders, but there is no policy for. They're saving municipal money. They're saving space at dumping ground. They're sending raw material to the recycling factories. But there is no policy, no plans, nothing. So this, we are working in 6 municipalities, not this one only. So there are very few municipalities who are really encouraging waste pickers, giving them proper work. And there is a rule that they should be integrated in the solid waste management. But that integration yet has not been done. People don't give them even I cards, identity cards. I mean, there are so many problems. But municipalities are slowly, I mean, they are so slow. And another thing is, sad thing is, there is a lot of corruption in garbage. And everybody wants to transport it, you know. Decentralized waste management will save a lot of money of taxpayers. But people are also not very positive for segregation. Even in this COVID, we have seen those who were segregating, they are also throwing mixed waste. They have just forgotten that we have to segregate the waste. So municipality has to, I mean, we are doing, but how much NGOs can do? Actually, municipality has to make strict rules that everybody will segregate, especially mask and all should not be mixed in the waste. They should be separate, with sanitary napkins and diapers and all the hazardous waste. Right. There is a lot of hazardous waste, like even the mosquito peel repellers and then the acid bottles and so many things are there, you know, which should go as a reject waste. Mm. But still they are there in the waste, sharp things, you know,
yes,
glass, broken glass. People are very indiscriminately throwing all these such items, and then really, I have not seen a single woman, a single waste picker woman who has she has no dog bite or rat bite. We say that there are so many dogs and rats in Mumbai and we held municipality responsible. But actually, we are throwing waste outside. To eat that, the rats and dogs come. So how people are also, and in the rules, it is written that along with the municipality with the manufacturers, even citizens are responsible for their waste. New rules, it is said, but still nobody is telling them that, telling citizens that you are also responsible for the waste generated by you. There are rules for EPR, extended producer's responsibility, and still the manufacturers who are responsible for that reject waste. So that reduce part of slogan, reduce, recycle, reuse, that reduce part nobody is thinking. Everybody is just having use and throw attitude, which is non-Indian attitude. Actually, yes, we were so recycling.
Yes.
Anyway, I'll stop here.
Anyway, there's so much to learn from all your experiences, Jyoti. I'll come back to you. Let me move on to our next panelist, Kedar. Kedar, you initiated this movement called Green Communities Foundation, and you have tried to streamline the process of waste management in buildings and housing societies and so on. What is your experience? Just if you can briefly give us a very quick update.
Yeah, Firstly, thanks, Roshni, for inviting us to this panel. Till about 5 years back, I had absolutely no background in waste or waste management at all. And like you mentioned in the introduction, I've been an entrepreneur in the research and analytics space, totally different from waste. And about 5 years back, one of the companies that I was managing got acquired, and I was actually looking at, okay, what should I do next as a venture? And that's when, so I was interested in some kitchen gardening and, you know, stuff like that. And around that time, somebody taught me how to compost at home. And just out of the blue, I started doing that. And I think that was the trigger. You know, they call it the butterfly effect, but I think that's what really happened. I just got hooked onto it. And as I went deeper into composting itself and then to the larger issue of waste management, I just got totally fascinated by it. And so around that time, while I had started work at home, I thought I should implement this in my society as well. And it was still a hobby for me or a weekend job. But during the process of implementing this in my own society, I really got a good sense of what are the issues, broad issues and problems related to waste management. Why are we in this situation? And what could be a possible solution? So I implemented this in my own society and implemented on-site composting, recycling, and so on. And that's when I thought, okay, maybe this is what I should be doing as my next venture. And that's how I started Green Communities Foundation. The idea was to replicate whatever I had done in my own society and, you know, onboard more and more societies. That was, of course, a tough one to crack. The reason is that most of the societies that we worked with, you always had a change maker there. Okay, that was the key person who initiated that project. And that could be an individual, that could be, let's say, a managing committee member, and so on. But they were really doing this not as part of a standard process that a society should be doing, because they were highly motivated and they knew it was the right thing to do. What I'm getting at is that as a default option, a society could just mix their waste and send it for dumping because it's a zero cost model currently for them, at least direct cost. We pay through our own taxpayer money is a different issue. But for a society, the default option is give mixed waste because it will be taken away. And that change maker who was trying to implement this system in his or her own society was really battling various odds. They were you know, trying to convince other residents who were either indifferent or at times, you know, even opposing what they were doing. Very few supporters. And whatever I'm saying right now is a generalization. Of course, you have several exceptions to this. And, you know, a lot of societies have really done this wholeheartedly. But what I'm saying here is what I've seen. 9 out of 10, you know, societies this is the approach. So this change maker had to really, you know, fight an uphill battle. And, you know, implement a system like that. And what happened was such a system is always fragile when it is built on, you know, a person or a cluster of people only supporting this, it becomes a very fragile system. And as Jyotitai mentioned, during the COVID times, we have seen, you know, people have abandoned their projects because this is not seen as something which is critical. It's something which is dispensable. You can do away with that because you always can fall back upon this whole pick up and dump system, which the city has. So I think this is what I have experienced in the last few years, where like I said, the change maker is driving this. But imagine there are like maybe 40, 50,000 societies in the city. Where will you get 40, 50,000 change makers? Mm. It's impractical to do that. So unless this is part of a standardized process, by process I mean there is very clear do's and don'ts. There are clear carrots and sticks associated with a process like this, and it almost becomes like a default. We are not going to be able to solve this problem at scale. We may do our few societies here and there, and also of course, I mean, every society that does this should feel proud about it. But if I take a larger view and say the city generates almost 10,000 tons of waste on a daily basis, then what percentage of of that waste can change makers prevent from going into the dumping ground? So you need a much more standardized system. It should become like a default. Think about it. Last 3 months, everyone is wearing a mask, right? I mean, who would have thought that a change like that can happen? But yeah, I mean, now if you don't wear a mask, you're an odd man out. But here today, if you are composting, you're segregating, you are given awards because you are the odd man out there, right? So the default is not someone who is really doing all of this on their own. So that's the experience I have over the last few months, but a few years. But I also have a sense of, okay, what should happen. That's how the journey has been.
I think I agree with you, Kedar, because I've also seen initially, maybe 15, 20 years ago, we were all enthusiastic. Let's do composting. We all, like, every building should have it. But then when you started to do it, we saw there were so many issues. People probably did not know to segregate waste. People did not segregate it properly. Like, you would find mixed waste and then somebody would try to again segregate it. So you would need more manpower. And then there were issues like road ends, there were issues like not doing it properly and all of those things. So, I mean, this decentralized part of it needs to probably be in a little bit more scaled up to maybe the ward level or something like that. So would you say something like this kind of works, or have you looked into it?
The more I think about, okay, what could be a solution to a problem like this, I think if you look at a city of the size of Bombay, now waste management should be looked at from as strategic a perspective as you look at electricity or water supply, road, public transport, and so on. You don't do this in an ad hoc way, right? Typically, you have a system for that. You're not saying, okay, each society should dig their own well for water. You're not doing that kind of a system, right? So what is the strategic thinking behind waste in the city? Now, I think the issue starts there. We can solve micro level issues of product and technology and all of that, provided there is a strategic plan for waste for the city. Now, who is driving that? I don't think anybody is driving that plan at all. And as Jyotidai mentioned, there is a lot of vested interest in this. Pick up and dump is a few thousand crore business. If we change that system, somebody is going to lose a few thousand crores. Now, are we willing to do that? If we are willing to do that and look at waste from a more strategic perspective, saying, okay, if I have to start with a clean slate, then what should be a system that should exist, which can, so decentralization is one part of it, but then creating livelihoods, which was mentioned earlier. So it could be either waste pickers, it could be young entrepreneurs and so on. Think about how many plumbers and electricians the city has, right? They solve a problem. How many waste supervisors or people who are trained in waste do we have here? I think you can name may not be more than a few hundred, I feel. So it can lead to, of course, livelihood generation and so on. But like I said, unless you have a strategic plan for something like this, I don't think we are even close to addressing this, forget solving the issue. So it has to start there, I feel.
So we definitely need some strategic planning at the state level and at the city level for sure. So I'll get back to you, Kedar. Meanwhile, I will move on to our next panelist, Monisha. Monisha Narki, you have a remarkable achievement as an entrepreneur, and in that you have been able to implement your decentralized organic waste composting system in 110 societies or projects, you know, and have it implemented on the ground. So what was your experience like? I think you would like to probably show us your a brief presentation, Monisha. Sure.
Yeah, good afternoon, everybody. And I'm really happy to be here today on Independence Day. So wishing you all a happy Independence Day. And it's an honor to be on a panel with experts like Jyoti Tai, who've been a mentor to me when I started my work in waste management. And of course, Kedar, who I've interacted and met on several occasions as well. So I'm really, and Roshni, it's nice that you could invite me here. So I'm really happy to be here, and I'll quickly share my screen and you know, give you guys all an insight about the work that we are doing. Is it visible?
Yes.
Okay, great. So as Roshni was mentioning about our successful project that we've done, and that's exactly what I'm going to showcase today, is a couple of case studies for all the participants here to show you that, yes, decentralized waste management, as Kedar and Jyoti have shared, is a long way off, but there are lots of successful working projects. And I think if those successful projects can become role models, we can emulate them across on a scale basis, and that's what we are endeavoring to do. So our organization is RUR, that's RU, Reducing, Reusing, Recycling. And the whole seed was actually sown with a vision to create eco-conscious citizens. So I started this organization a decade ago, you know, with my background in engineering and technology in terms of machine design. I had taken a break to become a mother of two children. And, you know, as a mother, you become very sensitive to the environment. And I was really motivated to, you know, back then I went to the Onarsh, Asia's largest landfill, which we've all talked about, which still exists, and very disturbed by the pollution and the cause of all the centralized waste management, this collection, transportation, dumping of waste. So that's how the seed was sown. And I felt that we really, as individuals, and that was way before Jyoti Tai said structural health commission or the property tax papers, we all started our work much before because we were connected to do something for the environment. And I think that's really the motivation to get people to take responsibility of their waste. It's not about payback, it's not about the return on investment, it's not about what the government is doing, it's about what you can do at your own level to make the air and environment around you safer and cleaner. And I think that's really a push with lots of projects. Even now in the lockdown stage, you know, we are selling some equipment. So it's not that we don't have orders, and of course they are down, but I'm optimistic because we are still having people who are adopting composting. So I'm really hopeful when I share with you this presentation today about some successful stories. So, obviously, you know, just a snapshot of what we do to make waste management successful is we believe that environment education is very, very important. And as Kedar said, you need those change makers, you need people to drive the project. So unlike a rainwater harvesting or a solar project where, you know, you just put solar panels and you may get solar energy in your building, or you may put a rainwater harvesting building and rainwater will get tapped. Nobody in the building needs to know that there's solar power or coal-based power comes to your house. So, but unlike in that, a waste management project requires people participation. Whatever solution, technology system you have, whatever housekeeping or basically community you employ or give livelihood to, people need to give their waste. And unless people give it in a clean, segregated form, the waste management project will not succeed. So education in terms of behavioral change is very important, and we do a lot of that. We set up a decentralized approach, because the good news is 70% of the wet waste is compostable, is biodegradable. You could make gas, you could make compost everything right at source. So you have 70% of your waste, daily waste coming from your kitchen, which can be managed beautifully at source. So that's a solution. And as Roshin was saying, you know, there are, the reason composting has not thrived is because of the failure in the project earlier, where, you know, a lot of conventional systems were used. There was to be smell, rodents, you know, systems would not work because it was tedious. Monsoons, 4 months, systems would not get balanced. So realizing that gap, that there was really a technology gap, is what motivated me to find a very simple solution which maps nature, and I'm going to show that to you as we go ahead. So that's something, and obviously CSR has been a great opportunity, because under the CSR Act, corporates can put 2% of their funds in different areas, and one of them is environment, and we can push for waste in that CSR, and we've done a few CSR projects which have helped us implement an end-to-end waste management solution. So this is the biocomposting system. Basically, it is an in-vessel technology. So it's a system where it's off the ground, because composting actually requires a natural environment. And as architects, most of you know that we've concretized all our spaces. I mean, buildings have car parking, and there's always paver blocks everywhere, and there's really no ground. So, and a lot of the buildings are sandwiched. So we needed something light, cascadable, portable. Again, we wanted to make it eco-friendly, so there's no power consumed in this system. And another feature is that it needs to be clean and safe. So as Jyoti Sai was saying, initially, waste pickers didn't want to put their hand into wet waste because it can get smelly and dirty in the beginning. So because it's a closed-loop system, there's very less touching or interface of the operator with the waste. They just have to open a clean lid, add the wet waste, close it, turn it, and so there's very less engagement with the waste, and therefore safe for them. Also, this system is closed loop, or like most investment technologies, composting is an exothermic process. It generates heat up to 60, 50 degrees. So any pathogens or unknown vectors get taken care of. So the idea is to make it safe, clean, hygienic, odorless. That's when people will adopt. So yes, you need people to participate. They need to give their wet waste, but you also need to find right solutions to implement them. And that's why we took, you know, to make this more attractive to people, or to make them more compelling, we even got it green co certified. So that's Indian Green Building of Council of India has a certification for green products to label. So when a LEED building or a green building adopts this technology, they get some points because it's green co certified. So that way, we are hoping more and more buildings who are at least going to LEED certification or care to do that would find interest in the system. So this is how the solution is, and I will show you a demo at the end. I have a small demo model, so you get a touch and feel. I'll have to go on the phone, but so the process of composting, I saw in the chat box, people wanted to know more about it, was that it's a very natural process. Like, you guys have all walked the forest. Have you seen any truck come and pick anything there, or anybody have to do anything? Forest sustains for itself. Leaves fall, trees, let's say flowers fall, fruits fall, everything breaks down naturally because there's an environment in the forest. And therefore, composting is like replicating. You can create a little forest in your home, in the window or in your building. It's a very, very natural process. So it requires three things: ATM, that's not anytime money, but air, temperature, moisture. As long as you keep the air, temperature, moisture in balance, you will have the process of breaking down food. That is your tea leaves, eggshells, meat, fish bones, fruit peels, banana peels, everything breaks down very, very easily. And in a period of 45 days. So as you can see, there's a bell curve. So it's initially stage is active, and then it goes through what's called a cooking stage, where it kind of builds up on heat, where you allow it to cool. And once the compost starts cooling, it gets ready in a 45-day cycle. And it's all about balancing. You need to add some natural browns, that's your dry leaves or your cocoa peat, or you can add sawdust, whatever you have available. Leaf burning is a huge waste problem across India, and we really need to take care of the leaves as well. So I'm going to talk about a building. It's in Mahim. You guys are all welcome to visit once lockdown is done and things are more easier to travel around. You can come for a field trip. But this is pretty much a sandwich building. Actually, architects mostly need to think about designing waste management spaces in the building. Most of the projects we go have no designated area even to hold the waste, let alone to composting. So there's never any space provided for this. So that's like a biggest flaw in the design of the building. But somehow we cramp out space because the idea is to make it lightweight and compact. So this has 65 flats. And they generate about 70 kilograms of waste daily, of which 40 kilos per day is biodegradable. And you see this pie, it tells you that when you put 40 kilos of waste daily, the amount of compost you get is only 10%. So when you have a centralized system or even a system to a central, you're transporting water technically away with so many carbon emissions. When you buy transport water, it's most 80% of your waste has water. So that kind of evaporates or breaks down, and you only get 10 to 15, which is very less in volume and it's very manageable. So 14 tons they have composted, and as you see, it's only 10% compost that they get. And they didn't have space because there's really no space in the building. So the project is on their terrace. So this has got six RUR green gold composters, each M size, and they are connected as a cascade. So they occupy very less space. That's the terrace garden. In fact, in lockdown, they've been so excited to have some mint, and they've been growing karela and brinjal. And since the residents couldn't go anywhere, they used to go up and water. The children also participate, and they love their terrace. And the whole May season, and even now in the monsoon, they're right at the seed phase in Mahim, but they've been able to grow a lot of stuff, including pomegranates and lemons. So when the building sees the fruit of the composting, they see the beauty coming out of it, they get more motivated to segregate their waste. So this is their process. They collect at source. They have three bins at every level. And of course, we have amazing housekeeping staff. They are trained. They love doing their work. They're motivated. So they collect their waste, they weigh, they keep records, they add the wet waste in, and this is how they harvest the waste in the compost, and they grow their vegetables. Yeah, they also take care of their dry waste. So they have a 7-bin approach. So when you have to maximize your recycling at source, 70% is biodegradable. Rest 20% is dry recyclable waste. So you have different easy drums. You put your plastic, paper, metal, e-waste, Tetra Pak cartons separately. That way you get more value. And this building actually has an amazing thing. They auction their waste every 2 to 3 months. So they get a higher value from the dry waste recycling network. So this is how 90% of their waste gets taken care of. And even during lockdown, it was only, a month that they have to stop their process because of the staff not coming. But ever since then, they've been continuing their work, and they've been managed to continue to recycle even in the lockdown months. So it is obviously motivation of the people in the building. But yes, it can work, and that's what we should look for, role models, and replicate them, because that's the only way. I mean, we could wait for a lot of systems to come, but it's going to take time. So it's important for us. That's a residential society, just a corporate example. This is near the airport, Vedant House. They have about, 100 odd employees, 15 kgs away. So if you see in a corporate, the wet waste comes down a bit. They have more dry waste, but their wet waste is from their canteen. And they also have similar, in their open garden space, they have put their units. A lot of training is required, but it's only in the initial stage. The first 2 months, you do a lot of training, a lot of teaching, but then the process is very natural and goes into autopilot, you know, so it is sustainable. Lots of these projects are like over 2 and 3 years old and working well, because initial seed is required. Once people are convinced, then they continue to participate. So as you see, just to show you some stats, but the compost is the orange one that finally you get. It's very less compared to the input. So it's very important to compost at source, because otherwise they're just transporting water, as I said. And you see, in through the cycle, it stabilizes at pH. The pH of the soil is very nutrient rich and it helps you to grow. So it depends on the space you have. You could do it at home. So there's a small home version. If you have a larger society with 50 kgs of weight, then you have a bigger system. So it depends on the requirement. Different systems can be customized to suit the wet waste. So also I wanted to share that when you talk about dry waste, a lot of recycling does happen in our country. In fact, we have very high levels of recycling in terms of a lot of our dry recyclables, because one, there are a lot of people scouting for it. There are lots of recyclers. So a lot of the recycled materials around you, sometimes you don't even know it. So the toothbrush box that you have, or your chai ka dabba, if you look, they're actually made from recycled paper. And even the auto rickshaw that you sat in some time back, the seat is actually made from recycled Tetra Pak cartons. The Tetra Pak cartons are compressed under high pressure temperature and flattened into sheets and even toilets, and you can make school desks. So recycling is a reality. It's about how we get it, and then it gets converted and gets used, and it's a whole industry by itself. Yes, there are some challenges, and sometimes we think we are recycling right, but are we recycling right is a fundamental question. A lot of us know that plastic bottles have a lot of value because they get recycled and they get converted into shirts. So one of the shirts Mumbai Indian team is proud of wearing is made from recycled plastics. But there are lots of challenges with recycling. Your seen waste can become unseen and contaminate the groundwater. So every time a Mumbai Indian shirt is washed, there are unknown microplastics going back into the drain and, you know, leaving their mark somewhere in the seas. And that's why recycling is still an ever-evolving technology that required to find right recycling. So ultimately, you have to first reduce your waste, because no matter what recycling we do, there are certain pros and cons and environmental impacts on them. And therefore, you have to adopt the first R of reduce and look for alternatives in whatever you're buying, especially one-time disposable plastics, or look for recycled products, make your own cleaning enzymes. A lot of things you can do at home level, at individual level, to really help solve this macro problem of waste at a micro level. So some hacks that I'd like to leave you guys with to take home today, as what you can start right after today's workshop, especially after you've heard Jyotitai and Kedar, I'm sure you're more motivated. Is some simple things. You start segregation at home, whether it gets recycled or not downstream, make that a habit. At least do your bit, put wet, wet, dry, dry, and keep red as reject waste and reduce your red bin, reduce that. You can collect your empty Tetra Pak cartons. We have 44 collection points across Mumbai. They're working, yes, even now in lockdown. You can deposit your cartons at Sarkari Bhandar or Reliance Fresh store, or write to us, we'll help you. Start collecting that one waste. Start composting. You can do bucket composting. You can get a system. You can get your building to do it. You've got to be a change maker. You've got to start today. And look for green alternatives, especially reduce your bin liners. I mean, everybody packs their waste into that plastic bag, which gets dumped. At least reduce 5 bags a month. Start with that and, you know, then eliminate. Like in my building where composting is happening, and even now in lockdown days, it's happening. We don't use bin liners. Our wet waste goes directly into the composter. So 30 bin liners per family reducing, it's a lot of bin liners we can save if we all do it, right? So these are 4 hacks. Simple, you can start with one today and then add them. But you've got to keep looking for more ways to go green at your own level and make an impact. So I think we have a lot that we have, as an organization, we should be doing a lot more. That mountain of Leonard is still there, and it disturbs me that even after so much work all we guys are doing at our level, it still exists. And I think we need to keep working. But the good news is that we have reached out to a lot of people. We have people composting, you know, and that is helping to grow green cover. A lot of people have put plants and utilize their compost there, so it's definitely mitigating greenhouse gases. And these are some things that we have achieved. We have a lot of volunteers who you can sign up as a volunteer also. If you feel you're not able to do anything at your own level, you want to help, you know, write to us, write to Kedar, Jyotitai. We all love people to volunteer because we need helping hands. and this is a huge mission. So I'm sure everybody will be willing to have you join up as volunteers. And yeah, that's some of the things that have kept us going. Of course, the recognitions help us to endorse our work. And, you know, being invited for webinars like this makes us more motivated that we need to keep up with our work. So that's been the success for us. And leaving with my coordinates. If Roshni, you have a minute, I can show the system. It will take a minute. If you have time, or we can do it at the end.
Probably we can, you want to show a demo or something?
Yeah, just 2 minutes. I'll just show the system, but I'll put it on my phone and show it on here. Should I do it now?
I'll yes, you can do
sure,
it.
Sure, sure. So what I'm going to show you is a quick, a live unit of how it looks. So you can touch, feel, and experience this whole thing. And you'll get an idea of how simple it is to do composting. It's not a tough thing to do, and you can start today. So I'll just quickly, okay, yeah. It's asking me the host has to let me in. Okay, they have, yeah. So I'm just gonna start with you here and start sharing. Okay, so. That's a second.
Yeah.
Yeah. So here you can see it's just a demo unit. So you see the lid is all stainless steel, so it's dustproof. It's got easy to open lock. So all I do is I just open it. I add the wet lid in here.
Monisha, we cannot see anything.
Okay, it's on my other window. There's another window. Can you see the other window?
No, right now we can just see you.
Okay. There's another window which says RUR green light. I can see it on my screen.
Okay. We don't see it now, as in we'll have to.
They'll have to pin it. Can somebody pin it? Green light.
I've already pinned this video, ma'am, but still I think
it's not clear. Okay, maybe then I think I can see it, but maybe you can't see it. Okay.
Ma'am, we can see it.
You can see it?
RUR green light.
Yes. So it's just simple, and you have to rotate it. That's all you have to do. And you have to select the water from below. And that's how you can do the composting very easily. These are the air vents. They allow the aeration in the system. So, and then you can harvest the compost as well very easily. Yeah, so that's it. Yeah. I think some of you guys saw it. Maybe next time we can share a video of it as well.
Okay, that's great, Monisha. I think it was a
wonderful
presentation. And good to see some actual case studies. There are lots and lots of questions streaming in, plus I have some general questions to every one of you, all of you. So let's see. But before that, I would like to we have amongst us today Mr. R.N. Mohanty. He is the president of Pidilite Industries and also the trustee of managing trustee of Society for Protection of River and Marine Environment, and he had some points to make about waste management. So, Mr. Mohanty, are you? Can you just come in? I can't see you in the list.
We have asked you to unmute yourself.
Is he coming on? I mean, do you see him?
Yeah, I do see him, but I've asked him to unmute himself also.
Yes, Mr. Mohanty, you will need to unmute your audio in order to be...
Yeah, I unmuted.
Yes.
Yes, sir.
So, I like the passion and the dedication of the presenters so far, and the way they are trying to mitigate the big issue, problem which we are facing. But as Mr. Kedar, I think Mr. Kedar said, we need a strategy for the all this, and this is a very small part of the waste in the towns, which is just, I can say, limited to kitchen waste or this. That also you can approach by controlling the input rather than the output. Now we are controlling or reusing the recycling or this. So you can reduce or make zero kitchen, zero waste kitchen, and control the input by legislation and cess on the city inputs, the APMCs. The main issue is the amount of waste we are dealing it today. Though I don't want to discourage the way your passionate people are working, but it is a very minuscule of the waste for the cities. The main waste probably is the construction industry waste, the waste from the other sources, which are much more like the hospital waste, the hotel industry waste, these wastes, the electronic waste, which are of paramount importance, and quantity wise they are very very much higher than waste we are presently discussing. Important, I am not saying. So we should consider these wastes with respect to the and this waste which we are discussing, the domestic waste, can be made more controlled by considering the material and energy balance at each society or a home. Concept of having a society as the unit is very, very good, in the sense societies are well controlled by cooperative efforts of the members. So, and they, if they are hold more responsible and treat at source instead of collecting them, transporting them and dumping them or doing whatever segregation and all, if they treat it at the source itself, that is in the society itself, like one of the presenters did, it is good, so that you don't have the hassle of the transporting and other things. So the effort is very good, but we should also consider the other type of waste, and the domestic waste we should use technology, more and more technology, and Roshni's favorite subject, biomimicry, how the God, engineer God, handles the waste. So that also, if you can use, it will be very useful. Thank you, Roshni.
Thank you, Mr. Mohanty. I think very good and valid points, and from all the discussion and from all the speakers who have spoken today, I think there's one thing that is coming out is that these small efforts or the individual efforts of all of these people is absolutely fantastic. It is so admirable that they have done this. But at the city level, what there is something is missing. There are, as Kedar said, there are thousands of societies, and we need to look at How do we look at strategically solving this problem of not just in cities, but also in other rural, small towns, villages, because everywhere this problem is coming up. So what kind of, what do you see as a way forward for cities as a whole? And I'm asking all the panelists, whether it is urban local bodies, what kind of policies or strategies should be there to support all of you? I mean, to sort of also give, take all the technologies that you have produced into consideration and take it forward. So what kind of support do you see should actually, or what kind of policy integration should be done for by cities or by municipalities or by state governments or governments? Jyoti or Kedar or Monisha, any one of you?
I can take a shot at that. So we spoke about the development plan, right? So when you are planning a house, for example, you plan so many things there, right? So your living room and your kitchen and bedroom and all of that. You also have a toilet there, right? So it is an important part of a house. So similarly, when you are planning a city and you are planning different areas in a city, waste management spaces, if they are not created in different places, it's like having a house without a toilet, right? And then you are not taking care of that waste scientifically. So it has to start at a top-down level. And thankfully, because of efforts by so many people out there, including Jyoti Tai, there is a plan there. There is something called as a development plan. And I would encourage every single citizen to check it out. It's available online. There's an app. So if you just type development plan 2034, you will see that. So every square inch of the city is mapped and it is allocated for certain purposes, right? So things like your educational institutions and hospitals and residential, commercial, and so on. So there are spaces allocated for waste management as well. Because mind you, not everyone can do on-site processing of waste. So think of slums. I mean, it's a huge part of our population. They generate hundreds of tons of waste on a daily basis. Think of restaurants. Think of so many other waste generators who may not be able to do this on-site always. Yeah. But then there is a plan at the ward level, because you have spaces allocated for certain needs. So it could be a centralized composting, biomethanation, whatever. I'm not getting into the technology. But there has to be a plan like that, which is everyone segregates at source, bulk generators and so on, they compost on site. But then there is this huge section of the city which may not be able to process on site, but definitely they have to segregate at source for sure and take it to a local center where you can have multiple streams of waste going in their right direction. So your biodegradable waste is getting converted into either compost or gas or whatever. Your recyclables are again going to the recycling centers. They are sorted and that's what happens. And the hazardous waste again is treated correctly. Now, unless there is a plan for that, and again, it has to happen at a top-down level. It cannot happen at a community level at all. You need the local bodies to support on this. The way you plan a metro, you find space for everything. You find space for a car shed. You find space for building the metro. Why can't you find space for doing localized or decentralized waste management? Those are the questions to be asked. So the question to ask is, okay, is somebody willing to do this? Then there is the ability. Ability is not a problem at all. There are enough and more technologies. More technologies will come up once this approach is there. So I think it's about the willingness to really have a structured, well thought out plan like this. And then everyone can be a part of that as stakeholders.
Yes, I think currently what probably is happening is, as you said, there are these change makers or some great people who are motivated. In these housing societies, it's happening. But we cannot expect that in every housing society, there will be these motivated people. And they may not be motivated after a while or something. Like I know that when the ALM movement started, the Advanced Locality Management, I think there were about 700 or so in the beginning, and they did fantastic job. Even now, I remember this whole VJTI area, it became so clean. Even now it is so beautiful. It's because of the ALMs which took it up. But ultimately, a lot of ALMs sort of dropped out, withered away, and or maybe they didn't get proper support. I don't know, but it did not continue. So, Jyoti, you want to say something, right?
Yeah, I just wanted to say that, as Kedar has rightly said, slums, you know, also generate a lot of waste. And there were some schemes. But then they were very unsuccessful because the waste was not properly collected from those slums. There were schemes, specific schemes to to collect the waste and then treat it. But space is most important thing in Mumbai. And space is not available. Even I tell you that whatever was development plan, the places allotted, they were also later on found that they were encroached. And though there are driver centers are compulsory in the rules also, but they are not there. If really you have drivers separated, because actually as per rules, it should not go to dumping ground. It should be diverted directly to the recyclers. And then wet waste can be, and even a dumping ground, why we should, because whatever we are paying, you know, as a tax for waste management, it goes only for dumping. Instead of that, there should be units, you know, where all this money should be utilized for various kind of projects, for maybe composting, biogas, or even we have developed small baskets for composting in each of. All such things should be done, and small efforts also should be done. It's not that only large, because I know there are lots of market waste is there. So even with that, we start with the decentralized small projects, and definitely, I mean, people should know how the waste should be treated. That is also people don't know about it, or sometimes people don't want to do it. Like as I earlier said, that some people were segregating, but with COVID they also forgot. So, and another thing is, you were talking about the small towns and all. The plastic collection is a big problem there. First of all, as I said that. There is a EPR law. It's not properly implemented. I mean, now, since the law came in 16, and now they are asked for suggestions and all that. And we say that from EPR, the support price should be given to this reject plastic or low quality plastic, which cannot be recycled, for that. Otherwise, why anyone should collect it? If there is no incentive. So the incentive should be there for the reject plastic. Other plastic or other paper is always recycled, but the reject plastic is not recycled. So that is also a big menace, you know. If you see when Mumbai is flooded, everywhere you see that reject plastic in the drainage. So that is also a major problem, but it is not only in Mumbai, but even surrounding towns and small towns also. And they really don't know, small towns, how to do it, how we can cope up with this small plastic. And there are no driver sheds, nowhere it is collected. So you will see, when you are going to small towns, you will see, you know, on the trees around, you will see the small plastic bags. And they are on the most of the trees, you will see plastic bags. Moment, you know, the ST goes, the people throw out the plastic from the windows. And that goes onto the on the streets. So all this, there is of course question of motivating people and educating them and all. But still, there should be, all municipalities should have some provision for constructing sheds, constructing biogas, or constructing composting. This then only this will improve, not otherwise. They do some DP and just give it, and then small towns also. And actually, it is. I mean, even amount of some municipalities, small municipalities don't have funds. I agree. All municipalities do not have funds, but those who have funds, they also don't do it. And in EPR also, EPR suggestions have been invited, but EPR also we feel that extended producer's responsibility, where again those who are manufacturing reject plastic packaging should be held responsible for that.
Right.
Then only, otherwise they will go on manufacturing and we will get some money, support price and all. But why? In the rules it is written that they have to phase out in 3 years. That was written in 2016. Now it's already 2020. And still nothing has been done. Now they are inviting suggestions again. So how we can implement whatever rules we have made, that is also very important.
Absolutely right. I think from what Mr. Mohanty was saying about circular economy and all, whether to reduce the waste, etc., at the source itself. So this is where, you know, the product manufacturers, the packaging industry needs to take needs to be actually monitored, because if there is a law in place, we need to see how that it is implemented, and we don't get this kind of waste in the first place, which is creating so much of a problem.
Yeah.
Monisha, would you like to add something to this?
I think the thoughts are aligned that we need a centralized strategy, especially in terms of material recovery facilities, which are MRFs, and there are lots of working MRFs as well, where the government can set up these bodies for especially the dry waste management. But I think what I really found that worked was when the government put a very strong axe on not collecting waste from bulk generators. So there's a large community of people who are bulk generators and who have the space. There's no excuse for them not to do this. So when the government mandated it, I agree that at least those who have no excuse not to do this should do this. So they're still not doing. And when the government enforced some fines and didn't pick up their waste, we got a lot of people asking us how to, you know, handle the waste at source. So they didn't pick up the waste at many places like, you know, offices, residential, for at least a couple of months. Which got people like, okay, if you leave the waste in front of your house or your building or your slum area outside and nobody picks it up, then obviously people will need to find a solution. So I think that the government plays a pivotal role in enforcing the policies that they have mandated, and they need to come down strong on this. And when they did, at least 2 years ago, they did a lot of exhibitions, they put fines, you know, they didn't pick up the waste for 3, 3, 4 days, people's waste was lying, people started calling, like, what to do now? And then we solved those problems. So I think at a strategic level, mandates are required, and across India, I'm right now staying at my farm, which is 3 hours away from Mumbai. I've been here for lockdown, and there's a lot of plastic waste I have collected in spite of having a low plastic life, but there's some things that you still get, especially your grains and stuff. What do you do with that? And so that at town levels can be easily baled. Actually, if they are baled at source or at a small level and then transported, you can still make.
Yes.
So baling systems, you know, small sheds with balers in small towns will really help compact, because all our waste actually is hawa or water. Pani or hawa is what we transport, and that makes the logistic cost very detrimental to the whole process. So once you remove the air and you remove the water by compacting, you can definitely help transport it easily, at least bring the cost down to transportation, send it to recycling. So and I totally agree that design and sustainability, I mean, a lot of corporates are now looking for making their packaging more sustainable. There is a lot of effort by companies doing this, but it's a long way off. So I think till the time EPR plays a pivotal role in pushing for the solutions.
Roshni, I had a point on the EPR and the brands as such. See, what has happened is a lot of the organizations, right? Typically, I'm talking consumer goods companies. You find in the remotest of parts of India, including Andamans and Leh, Ladakh and so on, you will find all kinds of products, sachets and food products and everything you will find. So organizations have built in distribution costs into their profit and loss accounts, right? But they have not accounted for take back of that post-consumer waste. And this applies to, you know, any manufacturer you can think of who generates waste which is of a non-biodegradable variety. By that I mean packaging and plastic and so on. They have not accounted for that cost. And that's my hypothesis, is that that's the reason they are hesitating, because it's an extra cost burden. They have to figure out who's going to pay for helping the system. So it could be at a city level, could be at a village level, and so on. The way they have spent money in distributing their product, their post-consumer waste, they should help in collecting that. By that I mean, like Jyoti Dai was mentioning, give that money to the waste pickers, or give that money to a gram panchayat or an urban local body, and so on, to ensure that waste is picked up, which will mean that this is an extra cost. But obviously they have to figure out who's going to pay for it. Do they pass that on to the consumer, or do they take a profit hit? They are certainly not going to do the latter.
Yes.
I think that's the thing which the government has to mandate in some ways. And so it's like I said, about working with different stakeholders and ensuring there is a holistic solution. So all, like biomedical waste, right? Jyoti Dai was mentioning, there's so many, diapers and sanitary pads. What are those sanitary pad manufacturers doing? Don't they know that their products generate this waste? And does their responsibility finish with distributing those products to the every nook and corner of the country? Don't they have any other responsibility for this? Can't they come forward and work with the local bodies? But since nobody is pushing them, they are not doing anything either. So I think it's as long as people are not questioning some of these organizations and companies, it will continue to be this way, because everyone will point fingers to the other person, saying that, okay, it's their responsibility, and so on. So it has to be a collective responsibility. Everyone should understand their rights and duties. What are my rights as an individual? What should I have in my ward as infrastructure? And what is my duty as an organization, as a manufacturer, as a consumer? And it's all very well laid down in the laws. So the laws are there. We don't have to recreate those. It's about really someone saying this has to be done.
Great. So I think,
Roshni, I just want to add one point, is that why the manufacturers of sanitary napkins or diapers are not told not to use plastic inside it? Because it is again one time use. Though we in Maharashtra we have act. I mean, at present everything is one time use only with COVID. But still we have an act. There is a ban on one-time use, but all the sanitary napkins and diapers have one-time use plastic. Why we don't have eco-friendly products, which are biodegradable? I mean, we are not asking these questions to manufacturers.
Okay, so I think I would like to summarize this particular point about what do we want from the government. One is that should be a spatial allocation for sure, whether it is cities or whether it is rural areas. Second thing is the extended producer responsibility, and manufacturers should take should be actually penalized if they are not doing the right thing. And thirdly, penalties should work at large, and if for people to take action. So I think these are very important points. I just have one question related to how this whole thing should be managed. You know, I have visited some place like in USA, in Jackson Hole, Wyoming. There is I saw such a beautiful center of
park,
of recycling. I think thanks to the US Department of State, I was able to visit these places and to see that it was done as a very profitable business. Yes. That there is a single girl who took this up as a business, and she's running this whole center with organic as well as non-organic waste. Recyclables are all entire city, and people pay her for collecting the waste. They actually, and she produces everything that is positively useful for the society back, like compost and all the other things. Similarly, I've seen in Tel Aviv, there is an aerobio plant which produces briquettes, which produces all sorts of HDPE and all sorts of things from waste. So can this not be a situation, given that the huge budget like a city like Mumbai has, can this not be given to private businesses to make business out of this sort of thing, rather than leave it to people and so forth? can this not be also a model?
Yes.
Yeah, Suchita, you want to go first?
No, you can.
Yeah, so certainly it can be a model. So if you just look at the annual transportation cost, right, and I may be getting the numbers a little up and down, but it's of the tune of a few thousand crores, couple of thousand crores is what the municipality just spends in collection and transportation. Now, if that amount is gradually, I'm not saying you can do this overnight. So it has to be a 4-5 year plan, which says that part of that fund, that capex, is used to develop a ward at a time. So you could start with, there are 24 wards in the city, right? So you could start with one ward and say that, yes, you are going to put certain capital expenditure into that ward or a couple of wards and set up the basic infrastructure. Which could be space, equipment, technology, whatever it is, training programs, educational material, whatever. Put that into one ward and then hand it over to local entrepreneurs, waste pickers, you name it. And my understanding is that every ton of waste generated a day can at least employ one person, if not more. At the very least, it can employ one person, maybe more. So you are talking about creating localized solutions for that. And the capex is paid for by the BMC and the opex is managed by the local teams. You have user fees. I think a very critical part you mentioned is user fees, because our current default is zero cost mixed waste. That is what we are battling, as anything will sound inferior to that, you know, heavenly model, which is I pay nothing and I give out mixed waste. That is what we are battling here.
Yes.
So unless we are, we have something which we have we can compare against, and penalties, honestly, I have seen societies pay penalties in advance and not do it. Okay. Yeah. So it is the most ridiculous thing that I have seen. So that doesn't mean anything. As long as you are paying per kilo of what you are generating, I think that is be the new comparison point. Saying that, okay, I am paying anyway so much amount, and by the way, there is extra cost if I am not segregating at all. Unless that is the new normal, you will not have people thinking of, okay, what can I do? Today, there is no reason for them to think of doing anything, because currently it's such a nice golden scenario.
Absolutely.
Right? So I think, anyway, I can go.
Yes, I agree totally with Kedar.
Okay, great. Munisha, you would like to add anything to this point? I think I have one last point. There are lots of questions, but I think they are generally already answered. So I'm not going to put them on, because I think in the chat box itself, they have been answered.
Somebody was asking, what is BMC? No. This is MCGM again. Municipality.
I think that just to sort of conclude, this one thing that everybody's, there are some in the questions also, and it comes down to a lot to what individually people should do or should not do, or responsibility or something like this. So, you can have all the great technologies, but ultimately it boils down to human behavior. And what we should do or what we should not do. And this is where the problem begins, because most people are not even wanting to segregate their waste. That is the first starting hurdle that we face. So what can be done to change this? Have you encountered anything in your experience that people who absolutely did not want to do things and they have changed because of something?
You have to constantly motivate them. That is, I mean, sometimes if
school children these days are already quite motivated, they learn in their school and they probably even tell their parents. So this is something encouraging, because I think there was a whole generation of people who thought that just throw away your waste.
Yeah. But at society level, nobody listens to children, no? I also want to, someone is again and again asking about debris, construction waste, what is to be done. I think there are rules and it's there already on the website. The technique is already developed and builders are again and again told about it, but nothing is happening. So unless and until you make it compulsory, nothing will happen.
Yeah, I think that
because it is an environmental issue also, because when you are not not recycling, then you are again digging the sand in the riverbed and again you are bringing it to Mumbai. So all these things can be avoided. So it's a larger environmental problem also.
Yes, I think that about 25% of the waste comprises of this building debris, if I'm not mistaken. And it is very sad. Sorry, is it more?
Yeah, still I said. No. Even if the amount is low, but it is not recycled. Yeah, and municipality, has one plot now allotted for this.
Yes.
But that we are listening for last 3-4 years, nothing has started. The plot has been allotted.
Yes.
There must be some reason, the tender and all that. Bureaucratically, they go so.
Yeah, I think people are still paying the contractors huge amount of money so that they can throw the debris in the night, mostly in the backyards or some place. And this is being all the time being done when this is such a good model wherein you can recycle. And I know there are a few companies such as Godrej Construction, which are actually making concrete blocks out of recycled debris. So this kind of model has such a huge scope that, you know, we have, for example, in every other house is doing interiors and we have redevelopment projects, so you can get all the blocks made from only recycled debris.
Yes.
And we don't need this fresh sand at all.
And road dividers also, road dividers, compounds, so many things can be made.
Yes, yes.
So, Roshni, I had a point to make considering a lot of the listeners could be related to architecture in some way, right? We had thought about this term called waste management by design. Okay, which means that when you are designing any new property, it could be a residential or a commercial complex, you are designing for ideal waste management. And I'm not talking about just giving some bins or having an area where you collect the garbage, but including signage, including the right communication. So because there are multiple stakeholders, right? So there are architects, there are builders, there is the housekeeping agencies. I've seen facility management companies, most of them are not familiar with waste management concepts. So let's say when we try to introduce waste management in a new society, you have to start from scratch. Okay, so your existing complex is not designed for waste management, even if it's a very relatively new complex. When a person comes to live there in that apartment, are they given any sort of communication? Now, I don't know whose role it is, but are they given communication that this is how you are supposed to handle your waste? You are given instructions about the clubhouse, right? What are you supposed to do and what not, and this is your intercom. Are you given instructions about what you are supposed to do with your waste? How is the new complex going to handle waste? But how are housekeeping agencies going to collect that waste? How are they going to treat it? And it happens right the first time. I'm yet to see a complex which is designed ground up for waste management in the best possible manner. And I think there is scope for doing that. Of course, it's a long shot, but at least new construction has to be waste management by design and not slap on later on where we have to look around for waste and you have to create communication posters and signage. Why can't a fresh building have signage about segregation and so on? I think there is something to think about.
Kedar, I feel that under DC rules, you have to make provision for waste management. So for showing, for getting approval, they are showing all that. But after the people
I agree. Absolutely, I know what the problem is, but
everybody
at least there has
society,
to be. For an OC, they will show a square and then they'll create it into a parking lot.
Everything is shown at OC. Yeah, yeah, nobody, you know, bothers to see it afterwards, what happened to those compost pits and all.
I think the problem here lies with the, you know, this model wherein the developer, he is interested in selling his buildings and leaving.
Yes.
And once the society comes in, then the society is the real stakeholder. So there are two different stakeholders.
Yes.
You should make sure that the penalty or whatever is there is directed towards the right stakeholder. So what is happening is after the society comes in, then, you know, the builder, if he says that you have to do this and you have to do that, people will not probably buy a flat in that house, in that complex. So he just wants to dispose of and go away. This duality is a problem everywhere. Whenever you talk about whether it is energy efficiency or water harvesting or water management or anything, but it definitely needs to be addressed. And what you're saying about signages and design, yes, in green buildings, so-called, it is supposed to be there. You're supposed to indicate the places where you can segregate waste. And there are, I'm sure, quite a few good examples of that, maybe few. And many of them are still following that. I have seen myself quite a few examples, especially commercial buildings, which are, you know, constantly monitoring, etc., and which have good facility managers, etc. So it is happening, but in a very small scale. As we are discussing today, what we need is a real scale up. And I think that all of you have given us a lot of good points, feedback, inputs, and suggestions. And I'm going to share this entire chat with all three of you, because there have been lots of questions, but like the questions were, you know, somewhat maybe you've already answered in one way or the other. So I have not asked you all the questions in one way or the other. I've also tried to ask you, but I want to thank all of you for coming on today. And I think the battle of solid waste or waste management is going to be long, and a lot of things to be done. But that's where your role is, and we will try our best as an institute to put your points forward in whatever we can to the municipality and with the other stakeholders. So I want to thank all of you, and I want to thank all the participants, and over to you, Prajakta.
Thank you, panelists, for presenting your work and your views on the topic, which is the meat of the hour. Thank you, Roshni ma'am, for summing up with the key points. Our next webinar will be conducted on 29th August at 4 p.m. We are skipping the next Saturday, which is on the eve of Ganesh Chaturthi. So we don't have a webinar coming on the next Saturday, but directly on 29th. Tune in to our Instagram and Facebook page for further updates. The link to join our pages will be posted in the chat window right away. Also subscribe to our YouTube page and do check out our past webinars. We would be soon announcing our short certificate courses, so stay tuned. And thank you for joining all today. Take care and stay safe.
Yeah.
Thank you to all. Thank you, Jyoti. Thank you, Dad. Nice to meet you.
Thank you.